I'm Dr. Dara Bliss Schwartz from Sharp Mesa Vista. I'm a clinical psychologist, and I want to thank you for joining us today to talk about loneliness. We have a couple of things that we're going to talk about today, including defining what loneliness is, the recent statistics and impact of loneliness, particularly in the era of COVID. We're going to look at the health risks, the physiological health risks, and the mental health risks. And we're going to talk about how loneliness actually can increase our mortality rate. And then we're going to talk importantly about what we can do to target loneliness. We're going to look at our thoughts, our feelings, and our behaviors, and different self-care strategies. At Sharp Healthcare, we like to start our meetings and time together with reflections, and I wanted to start off today by a reflection from Mother Teresa. The most terrible poverty is loneliness and the feeling of being unloved. As humans, we need connection. We need time together. We need to hear one another, look at one another, spend time together. And when we don't have that, we can feel very disconnected. Today, we'll talk more about that. So let's talk, what is loneliness? Loneliness is actually a subjective feeling. It's a feeling of being alone. It is not a fact. And everyone feels lonely at different points and times and for different reasons. It's a distress in us that results from the discrepancies between ideal and perceived social relationships, what we have and what we want to have. And often what we have and what we want to have in terms of connection may not match up. Let's talk about the difference between lonely or alone. You can be alone without being lonely. Plenty of people spend time alone and they're perfectly happy. In fact, most of us need time alone. Time just for us to focus on us. You can also be lonely without being isolated. We've all heard of people that are in a crowd of people and yet they still feel completely alone, completely misunderstood, not connected with. So we need to understand the difference here and how they kind of work together. So now let's look at some data from a recent research study on loneliness. This study looked at older adults who were experiencing feelings of loneliness and found that 34% lacked companionship and 27% felt isolated. Living alone was highly associated with feeling lonely, and 60% of those who lived alone reported feeling a lack of companionship. Loneliness can be a precursor to lots of different medical comorbidities. It can be a precursor to diabetes, stroke, coronary heart disease, lung disease, substance use, and a higher need of healthcare services. You can kind of understand why this happens, right? When we're lonely, we tend to isolate. We stay home. We might not take care of our brain and body the way that we used to. We might not select the best foods. We might not engage in exercise or the best hygiene. We might not be using our brain the way that we used to. And so loneliness is a red flag to the medical community that something else might be stirring and lurking about. For older adults, it's even more concerning. There's a lot of research out there that looks at the combination between loneliness and cognitive impairment and how loneliness can actually be a precursor to what's known as mild cognitive impairment or early stages of dementia. A study presented to the Alzheimer's Association International Conference in Washington, D.C., found that loneliness is associated with accelerated cognitive decline in older adults. Also recently, and very interesting, was a study done by Cigna. This study looked at 20,000 individuals, ranging from 18 all the way up into their 90s. And nearly half of those surveys reported feeling alone. What was really interesting about this particular survey was that Generation Z, which is those that are currently about 18 to 22, they actually rated themselves as feeling the loneliness. We actually suspected that it would be older adults, but Generation Z actually claims that they feel the loneliness. And the hypothesis around that is the disconnect that they're feeling from so much social media use, but lack of actually in-person connection. So let's talk about the coronavirus, because the coronavirus really complicates this feeling of loneliness. Just this past July, the CDC reports that US adults have considerably elevated adverse mental health conditions. We saw a spike in just Googles of depression and anxiety starting in March and April. People were looking to understand, why am I feeling depressed? Why am I feeling more anxious? During COVID, the prevalence of symptoms of anxiety disorders was approximately 3 times those reported in the second quarter of 2019. And the prevalence of depressive disorder was approximately 4 times that reported in 2019. Approximately twice as many respondents reported serious considerations of suicide in the previous 30 days than adults in the United States in all of 2018. That's staggering. So why? Why has COVID really shined a light on mental health conditions and loneliness? Well, social distancing has not helped. While it is so important for the health and safety of our community, it can increase the feelings of loneliness and isolation. Masking faces minimizes the ability to read facial cues and sense emotions from others. And mandated distancing can increase anxiety and concern for current and future health and safety. We've been told to wear masks. We know that masks are the way to protect ourselves and the people around us. But masks don't necessarily send our brain a signal of safety. They can make us feel worried for our health and safety. They can make us want to stay in our homes more, which is understandable, and the way to protect ourselves. But it can also make us feel disconnected from the people that we love. Why can this thing called loneliness do so much damage? We are social creatures. Our brain was designed to reward us for social connection. We feel a sense of support and security when we are with other people. Other people protect us. Other people make us feel valued. There are certain neural pathways and neurochemicals that get released when we are with other people. When we eye gaze and hand hold, we feel connected to others. And in the world of social distancing, we're not doing much eye gazing or hand holding or laughing or true listening face to face. All of those things take an impact on the brain and the body. There was research on mice who spent 2 weeks in isolation, and those mice showed higher chemicals related to stress behaviors, making them more fearful and prone to erratic behaviors. We can see that right now in humans that are being asked to quarantine and stay home. It's not our normal state to want to always stay home. So where is the greatest risk? Brigham Young University in 2010 looked at how being objectively isolated, someone who is factually living alone, and then subjectively lonely, they feel lonely in their heart of hearts, that combination is where we see the biggest risk for mortality and other health risks. So for people who feel lonely, but perhaps they have a big social environment around them, people are taking care of them, they're active, they're engaged, we don't see as many health risks. But this combination, objectively isolated and subjectively lonely, is something that you want to be on the lookout for in yourself and in others. So how do we measure loneliness? Well, we listen. We hear it if you tell us that you're lonely. But there are some measures of loneliness that are pretty easy to use. And UCLA devised what's called the UCLA Loneliness Scale. They have a 20-item version and a 3-item version. And they ask questions about companionship, loneliness, and isolation. So let's take it together. First, the 3-item version asks, how often do you feel you lack companionship? Hardly ever. Some of the time, or often. Then ask yourself, how often do you feel left out? Hardly ever, some of the time, or often. Lastly, how often do you feel isolated from others? Hardly ever, some of the time, or often. If you answered often on all of those scores, or often twice and some of the time on one, that would indicate to us that you are very lonely and need treatment for that, ways that we can help for you to feel more engaged. So let's talk about other signs that you might be lonely, because there are other things that can pop up. Are you withdrawing from friends and family? Are you losing interest in activities that you once really enjoyed? Are you becoming more emotionally and physically exhausted now than ever before? Are there changes in your appetite or weight or both? Do you feel blue, helpless, hopeless? Are there changes to your sleep? Are you having thoughts of suicide or self-harm? Are you feeling like you're more cognitively impaired? You can't remember, you get more confused. Are you a little bit extra irritable? Things kind of set you off quicker. Or are you avoiding social situations and staying home? Now, we're not looking for all of these. If all of these are ringing a bell, then perhaps actually you would meet a diagnosis of more depression or anxiety, and we would want you to call Sharp and get treatment. But if you're seeing one or two of these, it deserves talking about. Telling a care provider, your medical doctor, calling a hotline, but there are so many resources and supports across Sharp Healthcare to help you. Can we change loneliness? The answer is yes. Loneliness is a feeling, not a fact. At Sharp Mesa Vista, we spend a lot of time looking at the relationship between our thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, and how changing one of those can change the entire cycle. So if I think something that impacts how I feel, my feelings impact what I do or don't do, and that shapes future thoughts. That cycle happens constantly throughout our day. Recent research indicates that we might have as many as 6,000 thoughts a day. Let's look at some quotes about lonely thoughts. Change your thoughts and change your world. Norman Vincent Peale. I think, therefore I am. Descartes. The idea that our thoughts shape who we are, what we do, how we feel, that has been around since the beginning of time. Let's look how it actually impacts loneliness. Somebody might say to themselves, I am alone. The support I have is no more. I was more connected once, but now I don't drive. My wife's gone. What's the point? Those thoughts, what you say to yourself, has such impact on how you feel. In our programs at Sharp, we don't teach people to think positive. Thinking positive doesn't always work. There's plenty of things in this life that aren't positive. What we teach is for you to think realistic. Think from a balanced point of view. What would you say to a friend in this situation? When you were younger, somebody probably told you, if you have nothing nice to say to anyone, don't say anything at all. But did anyone ever tell you to apply the same rule to yourself? Our thoughts impact how we feel and what we do. So in this situation, we work with someone to understand there's a difference between saying to yourself, I am alone, and I feel so alone. I am alone sounds like a fact. I feel so alone, it's a feeling. It comes and goes. You have lots of feelings throughout the day. I'm not wanting to do anything, but that's the sadness talking. I'll try to be around other people at least 2 times this week. These small steps, these small changes that we make in how we speak to ourselves can change how you feel and what you do. So I ask you to ask yourself, are you feeling lonely? Are you having thoughts that are not accurate, that are perhaps not that compassionate, that could be brought a little bit more to a realistic, balanced place? And if so, I ask you to work to change that. Lonely feelings. We all feel lonely sometimes. Loneliness is a normal, natural feeling, and it is particularly normal to be feeling lonely during COVID. What I'm going to ask you might sound contrary to your instinct, but it's really important that you allow yourself to feel. Often when we feel distressing emotions like anger or sadness, loneliness, we want to push it away. That's our instinct. But remember, you were designed to feel. You have a whole region of your brain just for feeling. And so when we actually push emotions away, they wind up coming back even stronger. It's like that push, pull, push, pull, right? We need to think of emotions like waves that come and go. The analogy that we teach is when you're with your child out at the ocean, and you're standing with them for the very first time, and there's a big wave coming at them, and they're holding your hand in their hand, their instinct is to run from that wave. They want to turn and run from it. But what do you teach them? You teach them to jump into it, dive into it, feel the water, and then come up from it. That's the way emotions are. We want you to feel it. We want you to set aside time to feel it. If I tell you, pay no attention to the dancing monkey. Don't think about the dancing monkey in the back of the room going, hoo, 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 ha, 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 ha. What are you thinking about? You're thinking about that monkey. You have it all pictured. It's the same with an emotion like loneliness or any other distressing emotion. We have to set aside time to feel it with the knowledge that it will come and go. Let's talk about the behaviors piece. We talked about the thoughts and how thoughts can impact our feelings, and that we need to think a little bit more realistically when we can from a balanced, compassionate place. We talked about the feelings and how we don't want to run away from feelings. We want to set aside time to feel. Now we're going to talk about the behaviors piece. So when we're feeling lonely, it's normal that we might not want to do anything. I'm feeling blue, and so I'm going to stay blue. I'm going to stay blue by staying home, staying on my couch. Maybe I won't open the mail. Maybe I'll skip that shower. Maybe I'll eat some more, or I'll eat some less, depending on your inclination. This is extra worrisome behavior for older adults. Older adults need what we call behavioral and mental activation. They need to stay engaged. And when you don't, you're sending a signal to your brain, I'm not being used, so I'm not going to be used. And so you might find yourself becoming more confused, a little bit slower in processing, a little bit slower with your memories. That's what we call that early cognitive impairment piece that we might actually see from the loneliness or from early depression. So we're gonna feel bad, we do less, we feel even worse until we do even less. And so basically we're doing nothing. The way to bring that spiral back up is to do something, do anything. What we want for people that are lonely is, I'm not gonna ask someone that's pervasively lonely and feels completely disconnected to run a marathon or go out to a party. That's not realistic. I'm gonna ask them to set a realistic goal for themselves, like call one person that week, do one Zoom session, right? Pick up the phone, open that piece of mail, engage yourself in some way. At Sharp, we use an acronym called GRAPES to help guide us towards this behavioral activation. I'm sure many of you remember the I Love Lucy episode where they stomped the grapes. So for us, G stands for gratitude. Every day, ask yourself, what am I grateful for? Even in the midst of this pandemic and all the things that we can't predict, what are you grateful for right now? R is for relaxation. Do something every day that's purposefully relaxing to your mind and body. And I want to put a little asterisk to say that doesn't mean watching TV. That can fall in the pleasure section. By relaxation, we mean mindfulness, yoga, something that purposefully slows your breath and your body so that it is restorative to you and actually helps your brain and body in the long run. A is for accomplishment. Notice your accomplishments. Every day you're doing something that's accomplishing, whether that's making your bed, taking that shower, returning that phone call you've been putting off, balancing your checkbook, sending a present to a relative far away, whatever it might be. There's something that you might have been putting off that you've done, and that's an accomplishment. P is for pleasure. This is free game, something that's for you that makes you feel good every day. E is for exercise, and I'll put another asterisk next to that exercise because I'm talking about mental and physical. For older adults, it's essential that we do mental exercises, that we work our brains in different ways. I often get a question about crossword puzzles. Are those good for your brain? And the answer is sometimes. They're good for your brain if you don't do them all the time. If you're someone who's just great at crossword puzzles, then that falls more into the pleasure category. But if it's working your brain, if it makes you think and it's hard and you're actually getting a little bit frustrated, that's a good sign. So math skills, spelling skills, communication skills, all of those things that get our brain working would fall into that mental exercise category. Physical exercise, you've heard it before. It is so important to get that body moving. And research indicates that walking is one of the best things that we can all do for our body. So if you're not a big exerciser, that's okay. 20 to 25 minutes every day of walking is what your body needs. And S is for socializing. Socializing is extremely important in terms of warding off that loneliness. We're going to talk more about what we can do to actually keep that loneliness at bay in the coming slides. So physical distancing is not social distancing. I want to emphasize that. We've all been told or gotten the message to physical distance. That's okay. We want to keep that 6 feet of space between us and be in a safe environment. But we still want to be connected to people, people that we love, people that we care about, people that inspire us, people that motivate us, people that teach us something, people that we can teach something to. The three C's here: call, chat, check. Call people, get on the phone, use the technology that we have, chat, even if that's just for a few minutes to get your brain talking, connected to other, and check on people. Checking on others is one of the best things that we can do to get out of our own head and focus on other people. Connectedness, being connected, is one of the most surefire ways to ward off loneliness. You have to ask yourself, when do you feel connected? When I feel connected to people might not be the same as when you feel connected to people. So ask yourself, how do I know I'm connected to others? How do I know I have that good feeling inside? It's really important that we express ourselves. You see, one of the reasons that we're lonely is because we're not connected. And when we're connected, we're expressing ourselves. So one of the other ways that we can beat off that loneliness is to find ways to get it out. Get our thoughts out, get our feelings out, get our ideas out. Journaling, writing in any form, letters, recording yourself. If you can't write, if you have arthritic fingers or it's hard to write, that's okay. Push the record button on your cell phone and dictate, tell your story, talk about how you're feeling. Move, paint, art, dance, write letters, write stories, anything to get your ideas out of that brain. Self-care is extremely important right now. Put yourself in the equation. It's so easy for us to, you know, hear all the things that are going on and be concerned about the future and really be thinking about our loved ones. But you're of no help to anyone if you haven't taken care of yourself. If you are not of good mind and body and you can't care for others, then it's really not that helpful to them. So you have to spend time every day taking care of yourself. So we've previously talked about the importance of exercising your brain and body, and that bears mentioning again. But also I want to talk about the importance of control when it comes to loneliness. When we feel lonely, we can feel very alone and isolated. When we feel very alone and isolated, that can make us feel very anxious and worried and disconnected. When we feel anxious and worried and disconnected, we can feel out of control. It feels like all of this is happening to us and there's nothing we can do about it. And COVID has put a real stamp on that, right? It feels like I want to get rid of this COVID. I want everything to go back to normal and there's not much that I can do. One of the ways for you to decrease your anxiety and to decrease that loneliness is to do things that increase your sense of control in this pretty uncontrollable situation. That includes, of course, wearing a mask. That's something that we can all do to take care of ourselves. Eating healthy, surrounding yourself where you can with friends and family, engaging in activities that make you feel good. It's really important now more than ever to be kind to your mind. That goes back to what we talked about with your thoughts. Be compassionate to yourself. These are unprecedented times. This is hard. We are all navigating something together that we've never navigated before. So it's extremely important that you're kind to yourself, that you recognize the severity of these times and you recognize what you are capable of. You have been through hard times before. You are more resilient than you know. You have the skills and tools. When in doubt, think of others. Like I said, sometimes we get so stuck in our head. We think of what's going on with us and what we're not happy about with our own health and our own wellness. One of the best things that you can do is to focus on others. Think about how you can help other people, but balance that with that self-care that I mentioned earlier. Perspective taking is something else that's really helpful. The reality is we are going through this pandemic together in 2020, which is very different than 1920. There's technological advances, there's scientific advances, we're getting information at a rapid rate, we're sharing our successes, there's teams of people working together to help us so that we can become more connected. So in summary, loneliness is an epidemic within a pandemic. We're all feeling different degrees of loneliness together, and it has physiological and mental health consequences. But there are things that you can do about that loneliness. You can look at your thoughts, your feelings, and your behaviors, and you can engage in small changes to move yourself to a more active, engaged place and a more balanced perspective. Loneliness is a feeling that everyone feels, and everyone feels alone sometimes. There is support here at Sharp Healthcare and across San Diego. If you or someone you love is feeling lonely, please reach out to us. We're here for you.